morning, everyone, and welcome to our services here at the Bethany Christian Church. I'm not the only one doing that this morning. For some reason or other, but mine are sneezes from pepper or something. I have been away for a while. Usually three, I don't know, it's two. I'm so glad to be back. Elizabeth and I had a wonderful recreation period down in Florida, and we had good weather down there, but it looked like it was fairly decent weather here, too, while we were gone, although when we came home this past Friday, it was getting kind of cold. But we are glad to be with you, and we are glad to see all you worshipers here this morning. I want to draw your attention to some announcements. In particular, we want to notice that one Bible study will resume tomorrow morning, on Monday morning, at 10 o'clock in the library. We invite you to be there with us if you can. We have that Bible study at 10 o'clock. Also, all the regular choir rehearsals will be this week on Wednesday. We will have both the bell choir and the chancel choir, the one at 7, the one at 6, no, that's not right either, the one at
6 and 7.
Is that right? Yeah. 6 and 7. Thank you. Okay, I've been way too long. What's the name of this place?
Glasses talking up, bro.
Where are we? I do know this. I see that board game night is going to be this Thursday. I do know about that. And it's a 7 on Thursday. Looking forward to that. Next week, by the way, two weeks, there's a congregational meeting, and we're going to resume 5th Sunday church dinners, and that's a wonderful thing as well. And also, we'll celebrate the January birthdays on that day. Yes?
We have fellowship with people who are not baby, right?
The Christian Women's Fellowship will meet tonight, but not the Christian Men Fellowship. It's not that we are the fellowship, it's that we're just not meeting, or anything like that. Are there any other announcements that I need to draw to your attention?
We're welcoming back wherever to Koffenberger.
Right. You see, Ed Koffenberger is here again with us, and see, that's a good sign. We had a good Sunday when he was here before, but a couple of people said, "Gosh, I heard such good things, I missed him." So this was a second chance here. It is. I'm already looking forward to his message again. So we're glad to have him with us. Any other announcements? This is somewhat out of time, but I think some of you have heard about Sandra Hardison having a fall and has broken her leg, the femur actually. And she is in the hospital in Newburn. She did have some reconstructive, surgery on. She's indicated it's probably not a good idea to try to visit her because they're under so much pressure and stress with the COVID thing. It's hard to get in to see someone. And that's about the best you can do. I called this morning on the phone to the hospital, and even then, there was quite a lot of difficulty getting through. So anyway, I'll be mentioning that again at prayer time, but I wanted to advise you that let's begin our service of worship with our call to worship, which is on page 90 of your hymn book, Come Christians, Join to Sing. And let's sing that verse, first verse of page 90, Come Christians, Join to Sing, as we begin our worship experience.
Thank you.
3 weeks, and so I'm not up on anything other than that situation. It's good to see my friend Roger Serpredon. He had been ill, and missed Bible study for a fourth while, or been gone for a while, but I see he is back today with us, and I am so glad for that. Do we have any updates or situations that we need to hear about, whether they be hallelujahs or not, on our prayer list? Yes. Oh, thank you, Juanita.
I'd just like to thank everyone that's been praying for my sister, and she's still in the hospital in Hampshire, waiting to be transferred to the hospital in Maine when they have an opening to do corrective surgery on her artery. It's 99% clogged, and they're afraid she might have a massive artery.
Right. Oh, that's good news, though, that she can be able to find the right situation.
Well, they've found it, but she's been a week waiting to go. They just don't
know. Oh, gosh, yeah. And those kinds of situations have been hard with the, some of the difficulties we've had. Yes?
My mom's on the prayer list, and she didn't get very good news at her last appointment with the oncologist. So if we could especially remember her in the upcoming weeks, I would appreciate that.
Good.
Patty
Chance,
for those of you
who
don't know.
Right. Thank you. Thank you for that. Do we have any other? Yes, Christine.
The family of Shirley Manning. She passed away yesterday, I believe.
The family
of Shirley Manning.
Okay.
Your Honor,
yes.
My name is Cassidy Coppins.
If not, let's have our prayer hymn, and then the Reverend Ed Koffenberger will bring our pastoral and morning prayer. Our hymn of prayer is an old favorite, hymn number 570, Sweet Hour of Prayer, and the Sweet Hour of Prayer is, listen to the piano and the organ, they will keep you in time. Otherwise, when we sing Sweet Hour of Prayer, it gets slower and slower and slower. We will not let that happen.
Thank you.
For normally when we are given gifts, we want to show everybody. Indeed, we want to make sure everyone appreciates those gifts that we've been given, maybe even envious a little. But the greatest gift you gave us is that sweet power of prayer. And you tell us that prayer is often best shared with you in our closets alone. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for that gift of prayer being exercised all around the world, some standing with hands raised, some on knees, and truly some flat on the ground in prayer. And Lord, we pray as we sit in our places, as we bow our heads, as we listen to both the words being spoken, but also the words speaking within our hearts at this moment. That voice saying, I will be with those who are sick. I am already with those who have passed on. I am with you where you sit. I am with you when you drive home. I am with you in your home. I am with you in every breath you take. So, Lord, we give you thanks and praise for being so present. We give you thanks and praise for those around us who share in that joy. And we ask that we would remember this anytime and in any place. And we do so in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. There is no special music, apparently, as you can see, scheduled in your bulletin. There will actually be some special music later in the service, but not at this time. We are ready now, then, to hear our good friend Ed Koffenberger. He has been here before, and I thought charmed the audience and praised God in a most delightful manner in his sermon and his time here. And so we are all looking forward to, again, to the Reverend Ed Koffenberger.
Who is that guy you're talking about?
Yeah, who is that? Does he work?
Yeah.
Rats, I had it all set up with special music. You were going to be the baritone, you were going to be the tenors. Never mind. Okay, moving on. I really thank you for inviting me back again. I realize my challenge has now been doubled because the last time I was back here, the pulpit was on that side. I figured I only needed to talk to these folks. Now I got all of them here, now that I'm in the middle. But it was a beautiful, beautiful service. I appreciate being back and would like to start by reading the scripture for today, 1 Corinthians 12:1-11. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to the mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus is accursed. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of ministries and the same Lord. There are varieties of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given the word of wisdom to the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, and to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. And to another the effecting of miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another the distinguishing of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing them to each one individually, just as he wills. May God add God's blessing to the reading of these words.
Thanks be to God.
I have to admit, I was a little nervous about this.
the sermon until I looked on the bench outside and I noticed the Justice and Fairness lesson 7 that was part of this morning. And I took a deep breath. You may even hear a few familiar words today from that. My wife and I had just come back from a retreat for a week without any TV or without any radio. As far as we knew, the world stood still for a week while we were gone. Well, then we turned on the TV. You know, I never really wanted to be, when I was much younger, the picture of that older man sitting on the front porch, on the rocker, shaking his cane at every young person who went by, going, "This world is going." Okay, I will confess I'm getting a little closer to that rocking chair every day. I have to say, I really do believe that we are living in dangerous times, especially as Christians, and Christians who hope to share the Christian message with others who desperately need it. I fear our faith has been both politicized and monetized over the years. I see flags of Jesus' name flown in the midst of the most ungodly events. I've seen pictures of Christ wearing political caps and buttons. I even heard a Christian leader pushing his followers into one political camp or another, all the while pleading for funds to support the political party in the name of Jesus. And when I see and hear these things, I go through the gamut. I get angry. I get deeply sad. Then I get scared. I think maybe some of you as well. You see, today it seems like the logic of the world goes this way. Diversity is the reason for division. And to be different is to be dangerous. And if you're dangerous, there's no reason to listen to you, and even to allow you to speak if I have any means to stop it. Yet, this is not new. It's just a modern version of what's taken place throughout Christian history. Many of Paul's letters address this idea of difference as division and the temptation to force or enforce certain priorities of belief or ethnic backgrounds or particular worship practices as somehow being more sacred than others. Romans, Galatians, Ephesians, Thessalonians, and Corinthians in today's reading. Paul begins by clearly stating that even in our diversity, we all share one foundational belief, one essential understanding, one confession and profession of faith: Jesus is Lord and Savior.
Amen.
Good, I was going to ask if I could get an amen, but I didn't hear one. Jesus is Lord Savior. From that foundational and essential understanding, we can look at the diversity around us as gifts of God. One commentator on this particular scripture: diversity is not an unfortunate accident or a cultural phenomenon that needs to be eliminated. It is inherent in the divine nature. So when you walk out of here and you look around at all the trees, feel free to try to find two that are exactly the same. If you look around this congregation, there aren't any identical twins out there, are there? No, okay, good. Look around this congregation. There's nobody in here that looks just like you. Seems like God likes a sense of difference in the interactions of those differences. Paul's writing to the churches that Spirit-led people also act differently
They see and respond differently in the world than non-spirit-led people. And I believe Paul is writing to us today as well. Three general areas Paul points to are gifts, services, and activities. All unified as gifts from the same Spirit, the same Lord, the same God. And each is a manifestation of the one living Spirit. Each of the gifts, services, and activities are listed as individually distributed by God, demonstrated by Christ, and now empowered by the Holy Spirit. That means that everyone in this congregation has at least one of these callings and gifts to serve. And each such calling is held equally important to the community of faith and within the kingdom of God. Now, I have a friend, her name is Ann Mayo, and I knew her first as a little child running around with a three-legged dog where the college was, and then I went to seminary, and this young woman sitting in front of me in the seminary class introduced herself as Ann Mayo. And suddenly I realized that child grew up, and here she is in seminary class with me. And so we started having this conversation. And at that time in seminary, she was very big on social justice. In fact, during one of our conversations, she said, you know, if a Christian is just sitting around praying all the time, they're not really doing any good at all. I don't understand what all those monasteries and all those convents are about or anything else. And all I could say was, I don't know, Anna. You know, when I wake up in the morning and I think that there are thousands of people in constant prayer as the sun goes around the earth, I can wake up in the morning with a greater sense of hope. We as humanity have never lost our connections with the one God. And so I know sometimes, because we're different personalities, there's kind of that sense that sometimes this gift is considered better than that gift, or this one doesn't do enough, but that one's doing this over here. That's what Paul is writing to. The letter to the Romans lists other functions and duties within the body of the faithful when he writes, "For as in one body we have many members, and all the members do not have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another." No one sitting here today is unconnected to everyone else sitting here today. That wasn't meant for only the Roman Church. It's for us today. So I hope I've stated clearly enough that each and every one of you has a calling and are to exercise these gifts, services, and actions, especially with other Christians, and especially with those who are seeking the kind of community that our society is not offering at this time. Are you good with that so far? But I got to tell you, there is a warning label on this. Okay? You see, Paul tells us that spirit-led people act differently than non-spirit-led folks. Well, how is that? It's a short phrase within the reading today at the end of verse 7. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. In other words, we're given these wonderful gifts not so that we can pat ourselves on the back and say, boy, I got it, don't I? Okay. It's not so that we can get in our small group and say, hey, our little church group did a heck of a lot more than that little church group over there. And we can't use it to go down our list of good Christian to-do lists. Okay, good, I did charity today. Okay, check it out. It's for the common good. My brother, and I hope he sees this, My brother, younger brother, had this wonderful habit, and my mother loved putting puzzles together. But what he would do is when he found out what the puzzle was, he would go in and he would take one piece out of the puzzle and he would hide it. Because he wanted to be the one to put the last piece in the puzzle. He thought this was the ultimate win-win in a large family. So we would be working along, especially early on, before we knew he was doing this, and we would have them all together, and darn it, there wasn't that one piece missing, and people would scan out, and we'd be under tables, under chairs, looking under sofas, you know, corner rugs. We were looking everywhere we possibly could. And then his best surprise was while we were all looking, he would sneak over to the table, put the piece in, and walk away. And we would go, well, thank you very much. That for the common good, you can see that was for his good, but not for the common good. I can tell you right now, he works with children with behavior disorders, so he is spending all day long finding ways to put pieces of individual puzzles together. So it's not for our own private benefit or for ourselves and our party board. Check off the list. You see, to do things for the common good means that we may have to sacrifice some of our comfort. Because the good that you need may mean I have to stretch beyond my comfort, beyond my usual giving, beyond my usual time expenditures. It means they actually hurt a little bit for the common good. That's how we act differently than the non-spirit-led folks around us. I believe we as Christians are being called today to model the ways diversity enriches the faith, and dialogue allows us to better follow the great commandment to love God and love our neighbor. Okay, at this point, some of you are looking at the bulletin and saying, what was the title of this sermon again? Stained glass window. When he hadn't mentioned glass, he hasn't mentioned stain in it. What I'd like you to do is appreciate the beauty of the stained glass windows behind these church hats. Beautiful. And as I look at it, stained glass window being exactly the same as any other piece. And I think to myself, there it is. Each of us is some part of that sacred story. We may be down here, we may be up in the sky, we may be down at the feet of Christ. But each of us is there. You know just how important our faith is to the story. Pieces of glass was missing, even the smallest. I will be willing to bet you, if I was a betting man, I'd be willing to bet you that the first conversation at the door would be, do you see that little piece down in that corner there? It's missing. We are drawn to what's not there because we can't be a complete picture of the Christian story today unless we are all in it. Unless we're all willing to share our shape and our color and our gifts with one another to make the picture of God's faith and love in the world today. I also know some of those pieces of glass have some sharp edges to them sometimes. But boy, when you put it together, you can't get a more beautiful story than that. Amen.
Amen.
There may be those of you here who have not had a
lovely picture that is the cause of Christ as expressed in that stained glass window. An opportunity for you to be a part of that picture is presented to us as we sing our hymn of invitation. There may be those of you who want to be a part of Bethany Christian Church, or there may be those of you who have never confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That opportunity is presented as we sing our hymn of invitation, number 349, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Opportunity that we do have to return a portion to you.
of that that you have given us. We ask that as we do so, we will do it with a cheerful and generous heart, because indeed, everything that we have comes from you. This prayer we ask in your Son's name. Amen. I've been away for a couple of weeks and frankly have missed the worship here at Bethany Christian Church. I love Bethany Christian Church, and I come here by choice. There are other Christian churches. There are other places that I might be able to worship, but I long to be here at Bethany. I know the people here, and I know that in a special way, they are among the most generous Christians that I have ever met. And like Ed, as I get closer and closer to the cane and walking stick time and sitting in the chair, I will always know that Bethany is here and continues even if there is some diminution of my power. There are others who are here to contribute to that. We come here because of this table, not because of me, not because of Ed, even though I think we're a pretty good team. We come because Jesus Christ is head at this table, and he is there to invite us week upon week to gather around the table and share with him a feast of remembrance. And indeed, that's what it is, a feast of remembrance, so that we know who the Christ is that is the Lord of our life. And so we invite you all who call upon the name of Christ to gather around this table now. Christ stands head there, inviting us all to that table. And so let us do so. Our communion hymn in preparation for this is hymn number 272, The Church's One Foundation. And we'll sing, of course, the first two verses in preparation, and then the third verse later in response. Hymn number 272, Church's One Foundation.
Christ's name we pray. Lord, we continue to give thanks for the opportunity to come around this table today. Just as the song we sung says, you purchased our pardon on Calvary's cross. We know the price that you paid on Calvary's cross for our salvation. It is a price that we do not need to take for granted. It is a price that will save us all. We know, Lord, that the communion that we're taking here today is a physical communion. We're taking the bread and we're sharing the wine, which is the symbol of your spilled blood. But we are keenly aware that the communion that you seek with us is a daily communion. It is a communion of prayer. And I do think, Lord, and we've heard this today, the power of prayer in this world is so important. It's important for the world. It's important for this church. It's important to everyone that's sitting in these pews. We ask, Lord, that we be better Christians, and this communion will make us better prayers. We ask this in your Son.
God of you, he thanks and prays. While I mess in his bosom glows, and from his lips salvation flows. My blood I thus pour forth, he cries, to save the world in sin that lies. Partake, and when this cup ye pour, remember still Christ's dying hour.
Amen. Let's be standing as we turn to hymn number 272.
Thank you.